Chairman Trai, leadership of the ASSOCHAM organization, other dignitaries on the stage, friends, media. At the outset, I'm delighted to be here today, and I must compliment ASSOCHAM for taking the initiative in organizing this first ever meet, as the minister was mentioning, after the declaration of the policy. I'm also happy to note that all the significant stakeholders, and if I may venture to add, the architects of the NDCP are all sitting there. So the Chairman Trai has, based on consultations with you, put together the NDCP, and we have only taken it to the Union Cabinet. So any infirmities or gaps in the policy, I think, emanate right from all of you. So although we are speaking about the roadmap to NDCP implementation, I want to first of all flag here that we are looking at two larger contexts in which this mission is embedded. One is the roadmap for a $1 trillion digital economy. And we expect any day now that government will formally be releasing that roadmap. And this itself is embedded in a much larger vision. Here again, I am completely happy to hand over the baton of its architecting to R.S. Sharma, because as you all recall, he was the original architect of the Digital India program, where he not only spoke about what is the kind of aspirational vision that we should aim at, you know, he spoke about transforming India into a knowledge-empowered society through digital technologies. So that is the large vision that we have before us. But he also gave us the operational roadmap for that. What should be the pillars, and how do we actually go about, you know, establishing those pillars? So it is, I would say, in that sense, a continuum, starting from the vision of Digital India, which the Prime Minister unfolded in his first ever address to the country on that famous Independence Day. And after that, you know, much has happened. But let me also spend a couple of minutes on why I think this NDCP is much more important to the rest of India, and therefore it is incumbent upon us to ensure that this message is translated and taken across to the rest of the country. Because really, I think in the last year, you know, some fundamental shifts have been have happened and have become and are becoming increasingly visible. First of all, I think the backbone of infrastructure is now firmly shifted from physical to digital. Second, physical goods are now increasingly being replaced. Physical or even intangible goods are increasingly being replaced by digital goods. And we know that data is the new oil. That is now a truism. Nobody even, you know, talks about it. And the services are all becoming digital services. In fact, somebody sent me a very nice little clip on the YouTube where, you know, music is now, you just move your hand and the music comes on. You want to increase the pitch and then you raise your hand, the pitch increases. You want to increase the speed of the music, then you move your hands faster. So we're certainly moving into some very strange things that are happening around us. Today morning I was reading that perhaps soon I can expect my cup of coffee to be brought by a drone. You know, it's already beginning to happen in Australia. So when he spoke about autonomous vehicles, AI, of course, we all thought AI was, you know, well into the future, and we'll have to wait for Niti Aayog's report to be implemented. But everywhere I go, I just went to a restaurant yesterday evening in Bangalore. I barely stepped out of the restaurant, and it was already asking me, would you like to go to the, you know, nearest South Indian restaurant which serves you this? Are you happy with the quality of service? So big data, AI, all of them have already become fairly pervasive in our lives. And therefore, you know, both computing and communications are absolutely at the heart of this paradigm. So we cannot ever imagine, I think, a paradigm in which these two are not going to be center stage and are going to be fundamental to the kind of growth, to the rate of growth, to the magnitude of growth. All these indices are indeed going to be determined. And so communications is right there at the first layer. In fact, those of you who would have read the NDCP closely and the presentations that came after said that if properly implemented, the NDCP 2018 alone could yield an incremental GDP of 1.2 trillion. So your $1 trillion economy, NDCP alone could actually drive that. And the sum total of, if we put computing and all the rest of it together, could be actually much larger. And in fact, I was at the Intel 20 years yesterday, and they were then reminding me that 5G alone, it is estimated, could double global GDP. Global GDP, as you know, is around 80 trillion. And they say that in the future, this one technology, 5G, alone could double it. I'm not a consultant, so I don't know whether it's correct, but I'm sure Prashant and his team will work on that with all of you. And those TSPs who are going to embrace 5G, you can ask him to translate that into numbers for you. So, I mean, basically we all recognize that getting implementation of this NDCP is going to be critical to all of us and to all future generations as well. And just as we got the lead on the policy from you, you have to start leading the way in implementation. And I want to draw attention to this curious lag, because we always talk about disruption. If you look at any standard textbook, we expect that the industry will take the lead with some time lag, or in India with a substantial time lag, government will respond. And the regulator is supposed to respond much later, with an even greater time lag. In India, we are fortunate that we have a regulator who is leading the way. We have progressive regulation here. In many cases, not best practice, mind you. The regulator is setting next practice. We in the department are hoping that we will drag the ministry with us with a little bit of protest to match his speed. And I hope that the industry will not let us down and that you will move with the same speed. In which case, you need to actually start getting down to implementation. We have a long agenda list of more than 104 initiatives in the policy. I'm glad, and I really compliment ASSOCHAM again, because you've taken the lead. I noticed that the team, ENY, has done good work. You have indeed picked up action points, but we have to now get into implementation at breakneck speed. We do not have a day to lose. And I would request the TSPs to spare some time from the stress so that I can get into the NDCP implementation. And I'll tell you why this is important, because the only other country against which we should legitimately benchmark ourselves, China, is way ahead on every single parameter. You know that better than I do. What I can guarantee you and the regulator can guarantee you is that in terms of regulation and policy, we will continue the agenda that we have started, which is, you know, to make bring in ease of doing business, to reduce the burden of regulatory compliances, to ensure that there is greater convergence, to ensure that there is greater scope for the TSPs, you know, to play a role in many of the, to harness many of the opportunities, the digital opportunities that are rising. And I don't think any of us here can point out that the regulator has not done his bit. He has comprehensively covered all the areas that affect us, whether it is the cloud, whether it is data protection. And there again, an absolutely open, consultative, transparent process has been followed where you have shared your inputs. And I can tell you, I have spoken to many countries, and many countries are now looking at Indian regulations as a model for them to follow. I am not claiming that we have covered the complete agenda. What I am telling you, and you have heard the minister also saying that dismantling the entire architecture that exists today is not something that can be done overnight, but we have definitely started. A lot of reforms have already happened. Progressive liberalization and ease of doing business have come into this department. And definitely the regulator and I were just discussing that we will continue aggressively looking at these areas and address them. So I was mentioning that the only country with which we should legitimately benchmark ourselves, they have not only, you know, getting ready to roll out 5G, they have also started talking about 6G. Similarly, in AI, in, you know, cloudification, all the software-defined networks, I mean, every single one of them, they have moved a long way. And therefore, we need to move a long way too. In terms of the broadband mission, the public Wi-Fi. So let me just go through quickly some of the high priority items on which I hope that we will be setting up the task forces, and we will be co-opting you to start the work on that. The broadband mission itself. I do not know why some of the things that industry here looks at only as challenges are not looked at as opportunities. And in fact, I suspect that it is precisely this oversight where you thought it was a challenge to take 3G and 4G. This is exactly where other people have seen an opportunity and leapfrogged. So I think it is incumbent on industry to look at what, given the fact that we still have 600 million Indians who do not have broadband. That's a huge opportunity. So while I do recognize that you may have interim issues, that there may be a financial stress in the industry. By the way, somebody in the telecom department was telling me, Madam, you only came last year. I have been in this department for 20 years. There's been not a single year when the TSPs did not mention financial stress. I was happy to hear that. But we have to change that. So I am, as I said, I am looking forward to working with you on the Fiber First initiative, on the rights of way. Fiber First, we've already submitted a common utility framework as well as the draft to the cabinet secretary. We hope that the committee of secretaries will sit on that. On the rights of way, I have already told COAI that we will have a national workshop in the month of December with the state governments, where we will also launch the digital readiness index for the states. On the spectrum, we have got our recommendations from TRAI. We are working on them. We've already indicated a broad roadmap in terms of the NFAP, but we hope that in the coming months there will be you know, greater clarity on the timelines of the spectrum auctions, including for 5G and so on. The 5G roadmap, again, we need to do a lot of work all the stakeholders, because fiberization again is a key part of that. Industry 4.0, I think, and I've said this earlier, that ASSOCHAM, FICCI, CII need to play a much greater role in bringing other segments of industry on board, because at the end of the day, India's 5G roadmap cannot be simply a replication of other countries. We need to have our own use cases. Again, on IoT, a lot of work has to be done. Part of the regulatory work has already commenced, but more needs to be done here. Again, make in India. Yesterday, as the minister was saying, we have already launched the testing center, which is also part of ensuring that it's easier to make in India and get it tested in India. But here again, a lot of work needs to be done. So let me not go on, except to say that on all these areas, that is Connect India, Propel India, Secure India, there is a lot of work. And I hope that in the coming weeks, we can actually get down to concrete steps so that smaller groups can actually sit down and start working on this. So once again, let me thank ASSOCHAM for having this workshop. And I hope they will make sure that we get to the next step, because all the hard work that Prashant and his team have done here, we need to make sure that that is translated into action. Thank you.